लक्ष्मीकांत जी शुरू किया जाए। हाँ लक्ष्मीकांत जी, आवाज नहीं आ रही आप,
जी
मेरी आ
सर,
रही है?
रुकिए, शुरू करिए सर।
शुरू
हाँ
करें।
आवाज आ रही है।
तो बिल्कुल कल तक कहा जाए कहानी जहां तक पहुंचाई थी उसके आगे जो है कुछ कहानी कहने की कोशिश करूंगा आज। और आज अंतिम व्याख्यान है मेरा कनेक्टेड स्पेस पर। और सोचा है कि कहानी की जब हम बात करते हैं तो कहीं सुखान तक कहानी पहुंचनी चाहिए या कहानी से कुछ संदेश निकलना चाहिए, और तभी जो है हम सब कहानी को आगे बढ़ाने वाली बात करते हैं। तो शुरुआत में हो सकता है कि कहानी की स्पीड थोड़ी धीमी हो सकती है एक माहौल बनाने के लिए, बहुत सारी चीजों को करने के लिए, लेकिन जैसे जैसे हम आगे बढ़ते हैं और लगता है कि हाँ कहानी को खत्म करना है, और तो थोड़ी सी स्पीड बढ़ाई जा सकती है। कुछ बातें ऐसी हो सकती हैं कि जो मैं कह दूं आज की, हाँ इस थ्योरम का प्रूफ आप अपने आप देख लीजिएगा और इसको एक्सरसाइज के तौर पर छोड़ रहा हूं, और फिर भी अगर क्वेरीज होंगी आपकी तो बिल्कुल आप सबका ग्रुप है और उस ग्रुप में जो है इस कहानी मतलब थ्योरम्स और उस प्रूफ को जो है मैं प्रोवाइड भी कर दूंगा। लेकिन जितनी भी किताबें जो है डॉक्टर विवेक जैन ने बताई थी उन थ्योरम्स का प्रूफ उन किताबों में आपको मिल जाएगा, लेकिन फिर भी अगर चाहते हो कि भाषा हमारी हो तो मुझे खुशी होगी और आप बता दीजिएगा लक्ष्मीकांत जी को और वो जो है मुझे बता देंगे, तो हम वो प्रूफ आपको प्रोवाइड करने की कोशिश करेंगे। तो कहानी शुरू करते हैं कल जहां से खत्म की थी। और लक्ष्मीकांत जी स्क्रीन शेयर कर सकता हूँ?
श्योर सर।
मैं शेयर कर रहा हूँ अपनी स्क्रीन इस कहानी को आगे बढ़ाने के। कल हम लोग बात कर रहे थे कनेक्टेड कंपोनेंट्स की और एक थ्योरम का प्रूफ किया था जिसमें कि ये भी बात की थी कि कनेक्टेड कंपोनेंट्स ऑफ एनी मीट्रिक स्पेस इज क्लोज्ड। अब सवाल उठता है यहाँ पर आगे थोड़ा सा कि क्या, मैं क्वेश्चन लिख रहा हूँ ना, कि कनेक्टेड कंपोनेंट्स हैव टू बी क्लोज्ड। ये बात तो ठीक थी, डू दे हैव टू बी ओपन। तो इसके लिए सिर्फ मैं हिंट दे करके थोड़ा सा आगे बढ़ूंगा, तो आप कह सकते हैं द आंसर इज यस व्हेन द कंपोनेंट्स आंसर इज यस इफ देर इज ओनली अ फाइनाइट नंबर ऑफ कनेक्टेड कंपोनेंट्स बट नो इन जनरल। तो अगर हमारे पास फाइनाइटली नंबर ऑफ कनेक्टेड कंपोनेंट्स हैं तो हमारा उत्तर हाँ में है, और अगर ऐसा नहीं है तो हम कहेंगे कि नहीं, इन जनरल इट इज नॉट ट्रू। फॉर दिस वी कैन कंसीडर अ मीट्रिक स्पेस एक्स which is 1 by n such that n belongs to n union 0 of R, where R is a usual metric space. In this case, the set zero, which is a singleton, this is what, this is a connected set. And more than that, it is a connected component of X. It is closed. You can easily see that it is closed in X, but it is not open. Why it is not open? Because every open interval, can say that, that contains zero. You know this result very contains 1/n for some n belongs to n. And here you can also see that each of the component, hence the result, more than that, each of the component is the complement of the closed union of the other two. If you are taking like this, suppose we have this as a set, suppose this is a X, and if it is a closed, though you can say that each of the component is the complement of the closed union of other two, so it is open. Now we will discuss what is a totally disconnected metric space. So now I am a defined totally disconnected metric spaces. So what is the definition? You can say that a metric space in which the connected components are all singleton sets is said to be totally disconnected. तो कोई भी मीट्रिक स्पेस जिसमें कि कनेक्टेड कंपोनेंट्स क्या हों, सारे के सारे सिंगलटन्स हों, तो ऐसे मीट्रिक स्पेस को हम कहेंगे कि टोटली डिसकनेक्टेड मीट्रिक स्पेस है. एग्जाम्पल इज क्वाइट ऑब्वियस. यू कैन से दैट डिस्क्रीट मीट्रिक स्पेस इज टोटली डिसकनेक्टेड is but converse need not be true. Means कि अगर कोई भी space totally disconnected है तो वो discrete metric space होगा, that is not. So you can see example here for this Q in R, the open subsets of Q are of the form U intersection Q, where U is open in R. And we see here that none of these is a singleton set, so Q is not discrete, but Q is totally disconnected because every connected component of Q is a connected subset of R and is therefore an interval if you are taking, and the only intervals that are subsets of Q are the degenerate form. Think it and do it by yourself. Now I am taking another example that is a quite simple, which is an example of a Cantor set. Some people are denoting it is by K, or some people are denoting it by C. And we can see that this Cantor set is totally disconnected. Now, I think that many of you are in a undergraduate students. So first I want to define what is a Cantor set in a hurry. That is, you can take a closed interval 0, 1, and then you can take I1 like just this I0, or deleting this one. So this looks like you can say that 0, 1 by 3, union 2 by 3, 1. And in the same way, you can define I2. So what is I2? You have to just subtracting, deleting 1/3 part of this, and again 1/3 part of this as an open interval. So what is that? You can think that is a 0, 1 by 3, minus 1 by 9, and 2 by 9, this one, and union. You have 2 by 3, 1, minus 7 by 9, 8 by 9, and so proceeding in this way. So inductively proceeding, continue this process recursively, defining IN in this way for each N belongs to N, which is what to be the union of 2 to the power N intervals. So you can think this as a 0, 1, and you have a 1 by 3, 2 by 3. You are taking this as this is a I0, and then you have 0, 1 by 3, 2 by 3, 1. This is I1, and so on. Then we can define what is a Cantor set K. Cantor set K is an intersection of all these INs. So you can think that is IN such that N belongs to N union 0. It means it is I0, I1, I2, and so on. So I'm giving you one exercise from my first lecture, that is what is the boundary of this Cantor set. You can find it is the same thing as this one. Here you can also see that K is totally disconnected. What is the reason? Reason as follows. Suppose AB belongs to this K, with the A is less than B, then there is some X belongs to R minus K, so that A and B do not belong to same connected component of K. So the result. Now I'm going to define the one more phenomena, and which is well known result, that is, what is a path? So the word path and curve are used in a variety of ways in a different branches of mathematics. Now I'm defining this as a definition. You can say that let X be a metric space, then every continuous function f from closed interval to x is called a path in X from the point F0 to the point F1. The points F0 and F1 of X are called the endpoints of the path. I'm just writing a one result, which is a theorem, and I'm leaving this proof of this theorem as an exercise here, that every path is a uniformly continuous image and its image is connected and compact. So this is I'm leaving as an exercise. Then I'm going to introduce another type of connectedness, which is known as pathwise connectedness. The idea that any two points in a metric space can be joined by an unbroken curve in the space is perhaps a more intuitive idea of a connectedness than the one we have adopted. It is, however, a stronger concept than connectedness. Means you have a metric space like this, you have a A and B two points, and you have a path like this, this one, this one, this one, this. So अगर मीट्रिक स्पेस में कोई भी दो आर्बिट्रेरी पॉइंट आप लेकर के चल रहे हैं और उनको किसी भी कर्व के द्वारा आप ज्वाइन कर सकते हो, जो कि कर्व क्या हो, अनब्रोकन कर्व हो, तो हम कह सकते हैं कि ए और बी पॉइंट जो है आपस में कनेक्टेड है। और अगर ये पॉइंट्स आर्बिट्रेरी पॉइंट्स हैं एक्स के, देन वी से दैट एक्स इज अ कनेक्टेड। दिस इज द इंट्यूटिव आइडिया विच वी हैव इन माइंड, एंड दैट इज व्हाट हियर दैट इट इज बेसिकली पाथ वाइज कनेक्टेडनेस। नाउ मैथमेटिकली आई एम गोइंग टू डिफाइन व्हाट इज अ पाथ वाइज connectedness. So I'm writing the definition of this. Okay. Definition. Let X be a metric space. Then X is said to be pathwise connected if and only if for every AB belongs to X, there is a path in X with endpoints A and B. Example, the people know, but every normed linear space is pathwise connected. The continuous function t is going to, can say that t a plus 1 minus t b defined on a closed interval 0 1 is a path with the endpoints a and b. I'm just recalling what is a normed linear space. So you can say that a normed linear space is a vector space over the real or complex field on which norm is defined. And what is a norm? You can say that a norm is a real valued function defined on the vector space that is commonly denoted as X is going to this one and has the following properties. Number one property, norm of X is greater than or equal to zero, and norm of X is equal to zero if and only if X is equal to zero. Number two, norm of alpha X is equal to mod of alpha and norm of X. Then number three, which is a triangle inequality, norm of X plus Y, this is less than norm of X and norm of Y. and with the help of norm, we can define a metric, you can say that, or a distance by the formula dxy, which is nothing but that is a norm of y minus x. So easily you can see that every norm linear space is pathwise connected. Now I'm coming to another example, and that you have to see what interesting is the closure. In R2 of the graph cos comma, which is x sine 1 by x, such that x belongs to positive real number, of the function sine 1 by x. It is an example of a connected metric space. So you can say that it is an example of a connected metric space, but it is not pathwise connected. You can think no point of, I'm taking a set J, which is 0, y, belongs to R2, such that y belongs to this one, is connected by a path to any point in. However, it is easy to see that this gamma is connected, and it follows that closure of gamma union J, closure of this, is also connected. So here we have seen that one example which is a connected but not pathwise connected. Now I'm coming to a question. You can write, let S, which is a x sine 1 by x, such that this one union 0, y, such that y is greater than minus 1. So then it is exercise. Then show that I'm leaving it. S is connected, but not pathwise connected. Easily you can see this pictorially. That is, you have a minus 1, 1. You can say that 2, 4. And if you are drawing a diagram like this, so it is perhaps like this. This is basically 1, up to 1, and this is up to minus 1. And when you are reaching to 0, you will like this. I'm coming to a theorem. here I have given an example in which a space which is a connected but not pathwise connected. What about the converse of this? Here we will see that every pathwise connected metric space is connected. Now, going to prove it. Suppose X is a pathwise connected metric space, and if X is equal to phi, then obviously nothing to do. And if X is different from phi, so you have to take an element in X and you have to take, let this C be the collection of all images of paths in X that have A as an endpoint. तो ऐसा कलेक्शन ले रहे हैं सारे पाथ्स का कि जिसका एंड पॉइंट जो है क्या है, ए है. देन फॉर ईच एक्स बिलोंग्स टू एक्स देयर इज अ पाथ इन एक्स विद एंड पॉइंट्स एक्स एंड ए by the hypothesis. So that union of C is nothing but that is X. You can say that each member of C is connected and A belongs to intersection of this. It means C is a chain. Then you can say that then this is connected. So X is connected and hence the result. Now I'm going to do another theorem. That is also important. What is that? Every continuous image of a pathwise connected metric space is also pathwise connected. So proof is quite simple, and within 2 or 3 minutes, we can do this. So I'm taking the proof. So proof, let X and Y be metric spaces, and f from x to y be continuous, suppose x is pathwise connected, then we have to prove that fx is pathwise connected. So for this, for each AB belongs to fx, you can see that there exists xz belongs to this, such that fx is equal to a and fz is equal to b. And it is given that x is a pathwise connected. So since x is pathwise connected, then there exists a continuous map G from 0, 1 to x, such that G0 is equal to x and G1 is equal to z. Then what we have? Then we have FOG. You can see that that is again a map from 0, 1 to y is continuous, since the composition of a two continuous map is continuous. And FOG of 0, you can see that it is A, and FOG of 1, that is equal to B. Since A and B are arbitrary in fx, so you can say that fx is pathwise connected. Here I want to share one example. So you can write the image of a path is always connected. Why? Because the interval 0, 1 is clearly pathwise connected. So that every continuous image of this 0, 1 is pathwise connected. Now I'm going to introduce one more type of connectedness, which is known as a polygonal connectedness. Now I'm coming to a polygonal connectedness. So define a polygonal connectedness. I'm going to define what is a convex set before that, because so if you have a in a linear space, roughly I'm defining, suppose this is a V and X is a subset of V, then you can say that like this. If you are taking two points, X and Y belongs to X, suppose this is your X, एंड यू हैव अ स्ट्रेट लाइन विच जॉइंस एक्स एंड वाई एंड दिस स्ट्रेट लाइन कंप्लीटली लाई इन एक्स देन वी से दैट एक्स इज कॉन्वेक्स. तो यू कैन सी दैट एनी डिस्क लाइक दिस, दिस इज अ कॉन्वेक्स. एनी पॉलीगोनल डिस्क दैट इज ऑल्सो कॉन्वेक्स, इट इज अगेन कॉन्वेक्स. बट इफ यू आर थिंकिंग एज अ स्टार शेप और लाइक दिस शेप and you are taking x like this and this is a point and this is a point, so this set is not convex because if you are taking x and y then this part of the straight line doesn't belongs to x. I'm coming to define what is a polygonal connectedness. So for defining a polygonal connectedness, I'm taking our metric space as a linear space, or so here we are talking about in a linear space. So in linear space, there are other forms of connectedness. Which is we will discuss that convexity is one of them and a polygonal connectedness is one. So now I'm defining, giving a definition. Let x be a linear space and S is a subset of X. And if you are taking A, B are two points in S. For any N belongs to N, an N tuple C1, C2 up to CN of points of S will be called a polygonal connection from A to B in S if and only if C1 as A and CN as B. For each I belongs to the set, this one. You can say that the line segment, and what is that line segment? Just joining ci minus 1 to ci, that is 1 minus t ci minus 1 plus t ci such that t belongs to this 0, 1 is included in S. So here we can say that S is said to be polygonally connected if and only if for every AB belongs to S, there exists a polygonal connection from A to be in S. So examples are quite easy. I'm taking one example. Simple example is there. That is what number one. All convex subsets of a linear space are polygonally connected. Because for each pair of points, one line segment is needed to effect the connection. Now, we will see another example, which is a non-convex subset of C. I'm taking a non-convex subset of C given by Z belongs to C such that mod of Z minus 1 is less than or equal to 1 union Z belongs to C such that mod of Z plus 1 is polygonally connected. Now, pictorially, I will explain some more example you can see here, which will clear you many things. If I'm taking this one is C or R2, and we can think about this one and this one like here I'm taking this set. Suppose this is your S, and if you are taking a 2 point, suppose one point is A and another point is suppose B, and this set is not convex set. That is clear, because if you are joining A and B by a straight line, then that straight line is not completely lies in S. But we can think that here, this one A as a C1, this point as C2, then you can think C3, then you can think C4, and then you can think C5 equal to B. So this is a one example, which is polygonally connected but not convex. I'm giving you another example and also explain it by pictures only. Another example I'm taking. Suppose in R2 again, I'm taking S as a Z belongs to C such that mod of Z is equal to 1. That is a unit circle. And if we have a two points here, A and B, then we can say that it is not convex. That's true. Second thing is it is not polygonally connected. Why? Because we cannot find a we are taking like this, this, or this, this. So it is an outside dress. So it is not polygonally connected, but it is a pathwise connected. There is a path from A to B, and you can connect it by two different ways, A to B like this and A to B like this. So this is a one example. You can say that this S is pathwise connected, but not polygonally connected. So we have many examples here. And you can construct examples by yourself and question arises. You can think, अपने आप सवाल बनाइए, अपने आप करिए. और एक सिंपल सी थ्योरम का फिर स्टेटमेंट सिर्फ दे रहा हूं. आई एम गिविंग यू अ स्टेटमेंट, आई एम नॉट गोइंग टू प्रूव ऑफ दिस. Without proof, I am giving you two statements here. First one is that let X be a normed linear space, then every polygonally connected subset of X is pathwise connected and therefore connected. So the proof is a straightforward and I'm leaving it as an exercise. Now, we have three types of connectedness in a nonlinear space. One is a connected metric space. Another is a pathwise connected metric space. And then polygonally connected space. And we have discussed that if a space is a polygonally connected space, then it is a pathwise connected space. And if it is a pathwise connected space, then it is a connected space. But converse is not true. And we have seen many examples here. But one important thing and last thing I want to discuss with all of you, that we will see that how closely are these three different concepts of connectedness related to each other. ये जो तीन अलग अलग तरीके के concepts पर हमने बात की है connectedness की, कि वो किस तरीके से एक दूसरे से related है. तो we will see the statement of the next theorem, which shows that all the differences disappear when we are dealing with an open subset of a normed linear space. So I'm just going to state this result without proof in the form of theorem. Suppose X is a norm, is a normed linear space and S is an open connected subset of X, then S is polygonally connected, and therefore also pathwise connected. So this is a quite interesting, and this fact is used in the calculus of several variables to show that a function that has zero derivative on an open connected subset of Rn is necessarily constant. So this is last remark. This fact is used in the calculus of several variables to show that a function that has zero derivative on an open connected subset of Rn is necessarily constant. Now, thanks for listening me patiently. And I'm very thankful to all of you. Any question or anything, you can ask. लक्ष्मीकांत जी,
यस सर,
कुछ है सवाल?
सर कुछ सवाल है, हाउ ओपन कनेक्टेड सबस्पेस ऑफ आर टू बिकम पाथ कनेक्टेड?
रिपीट इट,
हाउ ओपन कनेक्टेड सबस्पेस ऑफ आर टू बिकम पाथ कनेक्टेड?
ओके, तो I will give you proof of this. I have also told that many proofs I have omit, and now I have no time to prove it here. Yeah?
Yes, sir.
Thanks.
Okay, sir.
Okay, thank you.
Sir, we are taking 2 minutes break, and after that you will introduce the next speaker, Dr. Bridges, sir.
Okay. 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 सर नमस्ते, मेरी आवाज आ रही है सर? ब्रजेश सर,
प्रणाम सर, अनम्यूट हो जाइए सर।
हाँ सर नमस्ते। हाँ,
हाँ नमस्ते नमस्ते।
हम सबके लिए बहुत सौभाग्य की बात है कि हम सबके बीच में डॉक्टर ब्रजेश कुमार शर्मा जी हैं, और आपने प्रोफेसर रामजीलाल के साथ काम किया है और 2001 से लगातार इलाहाबाद विश्वविद्यालय में आप शिक्षण कार्य में लगे हुए हैं। बहुत सारे रिसर्च पेपर्स आपने जो है पब्लिश किए हैं, और सबसे बड़ी बात है कि इस कार्यशाला के ऑर्गेनाइजिंग सेक्रेटरी डॉक्टर लक्ष्मीकांत जी ने भी आपके निर्देशन में ही शोध कार्य किया है। जब हम सब साथ में बैठा करते थे और कभी कुछ प्रॉब्लम फंसती थी इलाहाबाद विश्वविद्यालय की लाइब्रेरी में, तो सर के पास जाकर के अक्सर बहुत सारे सवाल पूछा करता था, और बहुत आराम से सर धीमे धीमे हम लोगों को उन सवालों के जवाब दिया करते थे। तो बहुत सारी चीजें पूछी हैं हमने सर से और बहुत लाभान्वित हुआ हूँ। उम्मीद करता हूँ कि आप सब भी जो है लाभान्वित होंगे, और अगर सर ज्यादा समय देते तो बहुत अच्छा लगता और भी, कि कई लेक्चर्स की सीरीज, और हम लोगों के लिए एक मुश्किल वाला सवाल हुआ था कि ऑनलाइन में हम कैसे पढ़ें और पढ़ाएं और कैसे बातचीत करें। तो मैं सर को आमंत्रित करता हूं कि वो अपना व्याख्यान शुरू करें। ब्रजेश सर।
सर अनम्यूट कर दीजिए प्लीज।
सभी पार्टिसिपेंट्स को बारह नमस्कार, और लक्ष्मीकांत और सत्यन जी को धन्यवाद कि हमें मौका दिया इसमें बोलने के लिए। हम लोग ये रामलीला सर के 75th बर्थडे पर ये कार्यक्रम का आयोजन हुआ है, ये बहुत ही अच्छा है। हम लोग सोच रहे थे कि हो, पर ये स्वप्निल ने, लक्ष्मीकांत ने, इन लोगों ने किया। रामलाल सर का स्मरण करते हुए हम इस लेक्चर को शुरू कर रहे हैं। तो लेक्चर का जो टॉपिक है हमारा, वो पीरियडिक नंबर्स है। तो पीरियडिक नंबर्स भी एक फील्ड है, एग्जाम्पल आपका फील्ड है, और हम आपने कुछ स्लाइड्स बनाई है, उसको हम आपको शेयर कर रहे हैं। अगर आपको कहीं प्रॉब्लम हो आप पूछ सकते हैं। जो पीरियडिक नंबर्स हैं ये एग्जाम्पल सब फील्ड है, और इसको हेंसल ने इंट्रोड्यूस किया था कि पॉलिंग पॉलिनॉमियल कॉम्बिनेशन मॉडुलो 3 टू द पावर n। मान लीजिए आपके पास इफ यू हैव ए पॉलिनॉमियल इक्वेशन विथ इंटीजर कोफिशिएंट एंड यू हैव ए सॉल्यूशन मॉडुलो p, देन अंडर व्हाट कंडीशन वी कैन फाइंड इट्स सॉल्यूशन मॉडुलो p स्क्वायर एंड देन मॉडुलो p क्यूब, p4 एंड एनी पावर ऑफ p। तो लेटर द इन सॉल्विंग दिस पॉलीनोमियल कॉम्बिनेशन ही इंट्रोड्यूस द पीरियडिक इंटीजर, एंड दैट इज द सेट ऑफ पीरियडिक इंटीजर इज ए इंटीग्रल डोमेन एंड इट्स फील्ड ऑफ एक्शन इज द फील्ड ऑफ पीरियडिक इंटीजर। सो देयर आर मेनी वेज टू इंट्रोड्यूस द फील्ड ऑफ पीरियडिक इंटीजर। सो वन वे इज टू डिफाइंड एज इनवर्स लिमिट ऑफ द ग्रुप्स जेड जेड नॉट पी टू द पावर एन जेड, एंड अनदर वे टू चेक इंट्रोड्यूस द कॉन्सेप्ट ऑफ रियल वैल्यू वैल्यूएशन ऑफ ए फील्ड एंड शो दैट द हेंसल फील्ड ऑफ पीरियडिक नंबर्स could be viewed as completion of Q relative to the periodic version. So as Q, we know that Q with usual absolute value, this is not complete. And if you complete Q with respect to usual matrix, that is the matrix given by usual absolute value, we get the field of real numbers. And same approach we take, we define an absolute value on the set of rational numbers for each prime P, and we complete Q with respect to that absolute value. Okay. So now we shall define what is absolute value R norm on a field. So an absolute value R norm on a field is a map from F to R, and which is non-negative, and absolute value of a number is zero if and only that number is zero, and the absolute value of AB is the product of absolute values of A and B. And we have triangle inequality, absolute value of A plus B is less or equal to absolute value of A plus absolute value of B. Like we have a norm linear spaces, so the field together with absolute value and it is known as a valued or norm field. So for example, usual absolute value on Q is an absolute value. And on any field, if you define absolute value of 0 to be 0, and absolute value of any non-zero element in field to be 1, then this is an absolute value. And we say it is a trivial absolute value. And now, if you have any valued field, then the condition 2 implies that it is homomorphic from the multiplicative group F star set of all non-zero elements of F with multiplication to R plus dot. This is group homomorphism. So if an element of field has a finite order, then mod A will be a root of unity in positive real number, which is in positive real number, so it has to be 1. So in particular, the absolute value on any finite field is trivial. So next, we shall define what is periodic absolute value on Q, and using this periodic absolute value, we define periodic absolute defines a metric on Q, and then we complete Q with respect to that absolute value. So periodic absolute value, let P be a prime, and if A is a non-zero rational number, then we can write it as a rational number is a, any rational number U by V type, U and V are integers. So we can write it A is equal to P to the power some integer into B by C, where B and C are integer, and B and C are co-prime to P. And this is because we have fundamental chain of arithmetic, any positive integer product can be written as uniquely as product of prime. So we can always get the unique integer for each A, which is denoted by VPA, also known as periodic absolute value, periodic valuation of A, and we define VP of 0 to be infinity. So then the function VP from Q to Z union infinity has the following property. So VP of A, B is the sum of VP A plus VP B. And VPI is the sum of VPA and DB. So equal to 2 and equal to B is equal to 1. So in that case, Vp of 1 plus 1 will be Vp of 2 will be 1 and minimum of Vp 1, it will be 0 in case P is equal to 2. So now we define the absolute value for any rational number by absolute value of P.
Excuse me, sir. सर थोड़ा सा माइक्रोफोन दूर कर लीजिएगा तो आवाज और क्लियर हो जाएगी.
अच्छा. तो absolute value of P A we define 1 by P to the power VPA. If A is non-zero and we define 0 if A is 0. So then this is a absolute value on Q because the property of third property is inequality bit hold and so we can take instead of 1 upon P, we can take any number, any positive real number between 0 and 1. And this absolute value is known as periodic absolute value. So for example, if you have a P to the power 5, so periodic absolute value of P to the power 5 will be 1 upon P to the power 5. So, but because of condition 3, so we have a strong thing, triangle inequality. Absolute value of A plus B is less than or equal to max. So an absolute is not needed.
I think due to network problems, sir has been disconnected.
That's true. Lakshmikant ji, sir ko phone kar lijiye ek bar.
Okay. हेलो सर आपकी आवाज नहीं आ रही सर. स्क्रीन शेयरिंग सर ऑन हो रहा है. स्क्रीन नहीं दिखाई पड़ रही सर, ब्लैक ब्लैक दिख रहा है।
तो किया है तो अभी भी नहीं
सर, एक बार डिस्कनेक्ट हो करके फिर से कनेक्ट हो जाए तो हो सकता है सही हो जाए। सर अभी दिख रहा है सर, स्क्रीन दिख रही है सर। यस सर, स्क्रीन शेयरिंग ऑन करें प्लीज।
हार्ड से स्क्रीन हो रहा है।
यस सर, स्टार्ट हो रहा है स्क्रीन शेयरिंग। नहीं हो पाया सर। यस सर, स्क्रीन शेयरिंग ऑन हो गई है सर, अनम्यूट करें प्लीज। सर आपकी आवाज नहीं आ रही। इस समय इलाहाबाद में बहुत तेज पानी बरस रहा है, तो मुझे लग रहा है कि सर के यहाँ नेटवर्क की समस्या हो रही है। सर जल्दी ही कनेक्ट होंगे, हम लोगों के साथ बने रहिए। सर स्क्रीन दिख रही है बट
लिखा हुआ नहीं दिख रहा है
अभी। सर लिखा हुआ नहीं दिख रहा है अभी, शायद लोड हो रहा हो। यस सर आने लगा। ठीक
and so now an absolute value on a field is said to be non-Archimedean if it satisfies strong Tangier inequality, and so we have characterization of non-Archimedean absolute value. So an absolute value on field F is non-Archimedean if and only if the absolute value of n into 1 means each integer in the field is less or equal to 1 for all integers n. So any absolute value on a field of finite characteristic is non-Archimedean, because in that case the set of integers will be a finite set. So now suppose you have an absolute value on a field f, and for x, y, f, we define x, y is equal to x minus y, then D is metric because of the properties of absolute values, and we say this is metric induced by the absolute value, and we regard a valued field as a metric space with metric on F induced by the absolute value on it. So all concepts of metric spaces, for example, convergence, Cauchy sequences, completeness, they carry over in a value field. So we can talk of open sets of valued field, closed sets, compactness, correctness. So the metric D induced by non-Archimedean absolute value, it's because the non-Archimedean absolute value satisfies a strong triangle inequality. The metric D induced by non-Archimedean absolute value satisfies a strong triangle inequality. Means DXY is less or equal to maximum of DXZ and ZY. And in this case, we say the metric D is ultrametric. And the metric space is said to be ultrametric. So if the metric function satisfies a strong ring, so if you have a field with non-Archimedean absolute value, then the corresponding metric space will be ultrametric space. And so the topology of the root is the topology of the metric space where metric is induced by the absolute value, and that is the collection of all open sets of the metric space. So now next comes, what is the equivalence of this absolute values on a field? So we say that two absolute values on a field are equivalent. Induced topology on F. It means that the metric induced by absolute values is equivalent. So two metrics on a set are equivalent. It means that every sequence to X in the matrix space B to one metric is also converging to the same point in the another metric, because they have open sets, same collection of open sets. Okay, so usual absolute value Q, this is not equivalent to periodic absolute value, because P to the power n converges to zero relative to periodic absolute value, but P to the power n is divergent in usual absolute value. Also, if P and Q are primes, so then periodic absolute value and quadratic absolute value on Q, they are not equivalent. So for this we may consider the sequence P by Q to the power n. Lakshmi Kanji, आवाज आ रही?
Clear आवाज आ रही sir.
आ रहे ने?
एकदम साफ आ रही sir.
अच्छा, तो अब so we have defined the concept of absolute value on a field, and then when two absolute values are equivalent. So now So now we like to find the criterion when two absolute values on a field are equivalent. So for this, we have two absolute values are equivalent if one of them is positive power of another one. So means if you have absolute value 1, absolute value 2, then if they are equivalent, there must exist a positive real number alpha such that absolute value with of any number, any element in the field with respect to 2 is same thing, is equal to the power of the absolute value of A with respect to first one. And we have a theorem due to Ostrowski, which says that any non-Archimedean absolute value, any Archimedean absolute value on Q is equivalent to the usual absolute value on Q, usual absolute value on Q. And any non-trivial, non-Archimedean absolute value on Q is equivalent to periodic absolute value for some prime P. Of course, for unique prime P. So these are the results, valuation theory of field. So the Bessel algebra by N. Jacobson are their book, unique analysis compared with real analysis by S. Cato. So any valued field, if you have a field with absolute value, it has a completion. So completion means in the sense that there is a valued field F and an absolute value, that F hat is a extension field of F, means it contains F as a subfield, and absolute value on F hat is a extension of the absolute value F, and F is dense in F hat related to topology provided by absolute values. So for example, Q is dense in R. If we complete Q with respect to usual absolute value, we get the field of real numbers. So to prove that any field, any value has completion, so now we are sketching the exist complete. F is absolute and 2 cosequence. The product of cosequence. So this sum and product are sequence. We have another person. And C is commutative and bandwidth.
I think due to network problems are again disconnected. Vijay sir, screen sharing off over here.
Ha, kar rahe.
Yes, sir.
Huh. So we have taken the set of all Cauchy sequences, and under the addition and multiplication sequence.
सर आवाज नहीं आ रही.
स्क्रीन शेयर हो रहे?
यस सर, स्क्रीन शेयरिंग ऑन है सर.
And a sequence is said to be null sequence if it converges to zero. And let B be the set of all null sequences in C. Then B is a maximal ideal of C, because if you take a Cauchy sequence which is not a null sequence, then it has to be after some stage all terms should be non-zero. So B is a maximal ideal of C, and to take F hat is equal to C by B, the quotient ring. So then this is a field. And if you take any element X of F and let X hat denote the set of all constant sequence, X is the constant sequence, then F is isomorphic to subfield X hat plus B, where X belongs to F. So if you fix with X hat, we can think of F as a subfield of F. So now we have to define an absolute value on F hat. So take any element, so that will be the coset of a Cauchy sequence. And now An is a Cauchy sequence, and we have this inequality, the absolute value in R, usual absolute value in R of absolute value An minus absolute value M is less or equal to absolute value An minus M. So because of this inequality, the absolute value An mod An is a Cauchy sequence in R. And since R is complete, the mod A converges in R. So if A is equal to some sequence, so plus A is plus B. A is represented by two classes. In that case, An minus An dash is a null sequence. So of mod A dash will be equal. So if we define absolute value of A to be the limit n tends to infinity mod An, then that will be a norm on F. And F hat is complete related to that, and F is dense in this. And we say that this F hat with the absolute value is the completion of F. So equivalent classes are co-sequences, and two equivalence classes are equivalent if their difference is a null sequence. And then for any element, the absolute value is defined this, like this. So now we shall define what is QP. So let P be a prime. We define QP to be the completion Q
with respect to the PI absolute value and PID absolute value we call the field of periodic numbers and its elements are called periodic numbers. So thus an element of QP is an equivalence class of Cauchy sequences of rational numbers, Cauchy sequence of rational number with respect to periodic absolute value with the equivalence relation two Cauchy sequences. And QP is a complete field, and the element QP if A is an element and it is entered sequence of value, we define its absolute value to be the absolute value of A. So we note that the periodic absolute value on Q takes the value P power n, n is integer, and also the periodic absolute value of each element of QP is also the same set. But this is not the case in case when we complete Q with respect to usual absolute value, because in that case it appears. So periodic absolute value is a complete field with respect to non-archimedean absolute value, periodic absolute value. So any field with respect to non-archimedean absolute value, then finally when we have, because of strong Pringle inequality, we have if limit n tends to infinity mod an plus 1 minus an is 0, this will imply an is Cauchy. And if n tends to infinity limit an is 0, this will imply an is convergent. So this is because of strong Pringle inequality. So now we saw that any element of QP has a unique power series representation negative powers of P, containing finitely many negative powers of P. So if you take the series with finitely many negative powers, where the coefficients of the series, power series in P, they have values, integer values from 0 to P minus 1, then this series has the partial of the series. This is a Cauchy sequence. So because of the periodic absolute values and strong Pringle inequality, so it means that and the QP is complete. So this series converges to an element of QP. So conversely, converse is also true. So we have a converse is also true, which says that any element of QP contains a unique canonical representative Cauchy sequence, which is sequence of partial sums of series, power series in P with finitely many negative powers of P, and whose coefficient are integers between 0 to P minus 1. So means a Cauchy sequence can be this class is represented as a Cauchy sequence. Taking an element of QP, a equivalence class of a Cauchy sequence, we can specify the series of the elements of a1 plus a2 plus an. So if a is an element with finitely many negative powers, and if it has a negative power is p to the power m, p to the power minus 1 comes, then the absolute value will be absolute value of a periodic number is d2. The value of representative coefficient and then take its limit. So that is p to the power m, if m is positive and now 1 is 0, d0 is now. And if it doesn't have any negative powers, in that case, its absolute value is p to the power minus n, if n is positive and dn is non-zero. So now we define what is a periodic number, periodic integer. So a periodic integer, that is a periodic number, is said to be a periodic integer if its canonical expansion doesn't contain any negative power of p. So thus the set of all periodic integers, we denote the set of all periodic integers by ZP. So this is not the set of all periodic integers, not the set of residue classes of integers modulo p. For that we shall use the notation Z mod pz. So this ZP contains all the power series with integer coefficients from 1 to p minus 1. Aapko it has to be 0 also, 0 to p minus 1. And same as the set of all periodic numbers whose periodic norm or periodic absolute value is less or equal to 1. So this means this is closed ball of radius 1 with center 0 in QP. Okay, so ZP, the integers, the ring of periodic integers, the closed ball of radius 1 with center 0. So of course ZP periodic integers contains all integers Z, usual integers. So this is subring or is also integral domain of QP. And the group of units, its units of ZP, so they are all periodic numbers whose absolute value is equal to 1. Means the constant term is non-zero. And now, if you take any element of QP and its norm is p to the power minus n, so then because of multiplicative of absolute value, x can be written as product a p to the power n times a periodic unit. Means each element of QP can be written as p to the power n times some unit. And units in have the periodic expansion whose constant term is non-zero. So net P being a closed ball, so the ring is a closed QP. And further, if A is periodic integer, it has canonical expansion I from 0 to infinity a to the power of ZP. Take the partial sums of this series, so the sequence of integers, and that converges to A. So ZP is closed, and ZP is limit of a sequence of ordinary integers. So it's that the closure object in QP is the periodic set of all periodic integers. So, okay. And also the closure of N in ZP is the ZP. So N is dense, Z is also dense in ZP. So now QP is complete and ZP is closed in QP. So ZP is complete. So the ring of periodic integer ZP is complete also. And also ZP is totally bounded. So means that for any given epsilon, ZP is covered by finitely many pulse of radius epsilon. So ZP is closed, completely bounded, is ZP is perfect. Now, and a compact space is sequentially compact. So ZP is sequentially compact also. So it is that every sequence of periodic integers has a convergent subsequence. So QP have the ring of ZP, ring of periodic integers ZP, and which is a compact subset. And now the QP, this is an ultrametric space, QP with periodic absolute value, ultrametric space. So epsilon Tengri inequality, if you take the sphere, then this is both opposed. And also, you make any open QP, in any metric space, open bars are open, but in ultra space, any open bar is closed also. Further, if you take the ball of radius R and take any element in that ball, then
sir, screens are disabled.
Okay, sir. Screen is being shared. Okay.
Why here? Sir, आपकी आवाज नहीं आ रही. शेयरिंग बंद हो गई
है. हाँ एक मिनट.
यस सर, विजिबल.
So
ultrametric space open ball. Each element of open ball is its center. So we have shown that this ZP is compact. If you take any element of A of QP, A of Z, this is a neighborhood of A. So it's a cubically compact. So also QP is totally disconnected. So totally disconnected means it has only connected components are its points. So, and now this ZP, the periodic integers, ring of periodic integers is countable also. So this is because of the ultrametric property of ultrametric, we have this. And now, because of this property, every point of an open ball is its center. The QP has the collection of all open ball QP. So this is finite. This is countable. So the collection of all open balls in QP is okay. So we have a important result, Hensel's lemma. So says that Hensel's lemma, a polynomial with coefficient in periodic integers, and if you have a periodic integer which is solution modulo p, so two periodic, we say that A is congruent to B modulo P to the power N, where A, B in QP. If a periodic absolute value of A minus B is less or equal to 1 by P to the power N. So once you have so once you have okay, so if you have a polynomial with periodic integer coefficient, and if you have a solution in periodic integer modulo p, and further this f dash a zero bar, this is not congruent to zero mod p, then there exists unique periodic integer which is exact solution. So we can use this Hensel's lemma to show that a polynomial with integer coefficient has a root in ZP if and only if it has integer roots modulo p to the power k. So means if you have a polynomial with integer coefficient which has a root in ZP, then it, if and only if it has integer roots modulo p to the power k. Okay. So the proof uses Hensel's lemma, and the integer is limit of a sequence of integers, and polynomials are continuous function. And now the QP contains all P minus 1th root of unity. So to prove this, we take polynomial x to the power p minus 1 minus 1, and we apply the Hensel's lemma. Now there is a result that any isometry of compact metric space to itself is onto, and this is also true for any isometry of QP. So any isometry of QP is also surjective. Okay. So now one can many arithmetic questions in QP. Whatever is discussed in for any field, we can discuss it about QP. Whatever concepts in field, we can look at the concept in QP. Likewise, there is a periodic analysis. One can discuss the differentiability of functions, Piatti-Galois theory, all extensions of QP. And then there is a vast literature about QP. Okay. So with this, I stop my lecture and thanks to you. If you have any question, you can ask.
थैंक यू सर, थैंक यू सो मच सर. अगर पार्टिसिपेंट्स के कोई क्वेश्चन हो तो आप उसमें कमेंट बॉक्स में लिख सकते हैं जल्दी से, अदरवाइज लोग लेक्चर को एंड करेंगे. इज देयर एनी क्वेश्चन?
हम यूपी डिफेंड की डिफेंड और के अंदर पीएडी की इंटीजर डिफाइन करें
सर. देयर इज अ क्वेश्चन, प्लीज एक्सप्लेन द मैप वीपी वैल्यूएशन.
अच्छा तो वी
आई थिंक ड्यू टू नेटवर्क एरर अगेन सर वी डिस्कनेक्टेड.
हाँ शेयर नहीं, अब चाहिए शेयर नहीं करना है, वापस करो, शेयर नहीं करना. वीडियो ऑन करो, वीडियो नहीं आ रहा हमारा. हाँ तो जैसे पी को टू हम ले लें तो, और रेशनल नंबर हमारा 1/2 है, तो टू 1/2 वी कैन राइट 2^-1 × 1. और या अगर p मान लीजिए 2 है और 1/6 और 4/5 है, p is 2 and a is 4/5, so we can write 4/5 as 2² × 1/5. Means whatever, if any rational number, write it as p to the power some, p either will come in numerator or denominator. We can cancel the powers of p if there are numerator and denominator and take out that power. So that is the VP. Okay. For example, V5 of 1/6. So V5 of 1/6. So only 0 power will come. So V5 of 1/6 will be 0. And V5 of 1/5 will be -1. V5 of 30. So 30 is 6 × 5. So V5 of 30, it will be 1.
Okay, sir. So there is one more question, sir. Give a construction of a p-adic number. Give a construction of a p-adic number. I think this question is asked by Ratan Lal, and I am unable to understand this question. Are you able, sir?
No. What is the question?
Give a construction of a p-adic number.
There is a construction. We have seen that any element has a representation as a powers in P with finitely many negative powers. So
yes sir.
So all of course the rational numbers are periodic numbers, and the series 1/p^i from 0 to infinity, the series also a periodic number. And then one can in real we have exponential series x^(n)·n, and from 0 to infinity this is convergent. Then what will be the convergence of the same series in p-adic QP? So that we can discuss the power series theory in the QP also.
ओके सर, थैंक यू सो मच सर. जबकि प्रयागराज में इस समय बारिश हो रही है और आपके यहाँ नेटवर्क की भी समस्या है, इसके बावजूद आपने सर इतना बढ़िया तरीके से सबको सी एडिक नंबर्स के बारे में बताया, बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद सर. और हमारे लिए गौरव की बात है सर कि आप हमारे रिसर्च गाइड, हमें आपने MSc में भी पढ़ाया है और आप हमारे इस वर्कशॉप में एक स्पेशल लेक्चर के मतलब दे रहे हैं सर. ये हमारे लिए बहुत गौरव की बात है, बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद सर. और अब हम लोग मिलते हैं 1 बजे नेक्स्ट लेक्चर के लिए. थैंक यू सो मच. थैंक यू सर.
थैंक यू.